Good morning, everyone. You ready to go this morning? Awesome. We've already had a really, really great morning. 9 o'clock was beautiful. Well, I don't know how many were there, but over this weekend, we really have had a lot happen just in the last few days. Was there anyone at the marriage conference? Can you just yell out? There you go, quite a few of you. That's powerful, wasn't it? Just an incredible 2 days of almost 1,500 couples between Orion Campus and Troy and Orlando, gathering together, getting intentional time with God to say, Lord, we want to bring our marriage, our relationship to you. Will you speak to us? And really, this first song that Jacqueline's going to lead us in is a song that's saying, Lord, would you be king of my heart? And that's what this whole weekend's really been about. So what today's going to be about. I think that's what every single weekend is about, really, when you get to the core of it. And these lyrics are perfect for our day. It's called King of My Heart. And so I'm going to invite you, if you'd like to stand up. You don't have to, of course not. But if you're led to stand up and sing this song with us.
Let the king of my heart be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from. Oh, he is my song. Let the king of my heart be the shadow.
His promise,
you're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down.
Sing it out to him,
you're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let.
I guarantee you something. This is a great family moment. That man right there is supposed to be on stage. He's just talking to everybody. Hey, come on. You're killing me up here. All right, you gotta sing this then. You gotta sing him on. You're never gonna let, he's gonna let us down. But God will never let us down. Sing it to him.
You're never gonna let
Steve Andrews will let us down, but God will never let us down.
That's right.
You're never gonna let
me down. Awesome. Okay. You may be seated. As Danny was singing that, what hit me was 43 years ago, I was playing golf with my dad and my two brothers, and I caught my dad cheating. He did a foot wedge around a tree. It was him and me competing against my two brothers. And I watched him move the ball about just 18 inches to the left in order to get it. He actually had a shot at the green. My dad was a really good golfer and a cheater. And I was like, Dad, you can't do that, man. There's no integrity in that. And we had this big argument, this big fight. And he said something to me I never forgot. He said, son, he said, if you're counting on me to never let you down, he said, you are in big trouble. Because I'm going to let you down. I said, well, I don't care. Stop using your foot as a foot wedge. But we are here today because there is one who won't let us down, right? That's what we're hoping for. Either you were dragged here against your will, or you came hoping that there's a God who loves you and cares about you and can meet you right where you are. Is that cool? All right, so glad you're here. So, starting point. If you're brand new here today, you're coming with friends, we'd love to have you. We've been celebrating all weekend. This is just one of those unbelievable weekends in Kensington with vertical marriage. This place was packed all Friday night and Saturday. Dave and Ann teaching us a lot of life change. Were some of you, any of you here for that? A couple of you? Okay, so some of you. It's powerful, wasn't it? And so today, I am hoping to help you break some craziness. So I'm really glad you're here. I've been praying for young couples especially. And so this is really cool. I want to just let you know one announcement. And that is Good Friday and Easter are coming. Easter tickets are on sale. I want you to see something. The theme for Good Friday this year and Easter is the word torn. And I'm just going to give you just one sneak preview. In the Bible, when Jesus was in Israel, the Jewish people worshiped at the temple. It was originally the tabernacle, became a permanent building called the temple, and there was this huge curtain. It was 18 inches thick that no one could go behind, because behind it was where God's glory dwelt, with where the Ark of the Covenant was. One high priest, one time a year, could go behind this curtain, and they would actually tie a rope to his ankle that if God was displeased with him, they could pull the dead body out from behind there. Imagine that. On Good Friday, the veil gets ripped from top to bottom. And the holy place where God dwells with all his glory gets opened up for all to see and for everyone to experience. So torn becomes the worst word about Jesus, the best word for us. And then on Easter, if you don't, be a little subtle here, ready? Then we get to Easter. You see where we're going with this? Is that a little too tricky for you? We're talking about the light breaking through and about how the resurrection will change everything. So I want to grab your tickets and enjoy and just really make that happen. Okay, so the tickets are online. We have 7 Easter services, 3 good, you don't need tickets for Good Friday, it's 3 Good Friday services. Look forward for you and friends and people connected. This is gonna be a huge blessing for people's lives. So before we continue, I would love for you to stand up, squeeze a little bit to make room for latecomers, and say hi to a couple people around you.
Well, we are in the second week of a series that we're calling Bank, and Steve Andrews just did a beautiful job last week teaching us about what it means to have generosity, rooted in our heart. By the way, God is a generous God, so it's a quality of His. So how do we get more of that to come out of our life? And today, like he also mentioned, we're going to talk about how to potentially stay away from this crazy cycle that we can get in that can hinder us from living a generous life. And so as we were planning this service, one of our creatives, Mike Nelson, who produced this service, wanted this particular moment before Steve came up. And I asked him, I said, hey, what are you sensing that God wants a thought in our community to have before we go into the teaching? So he explained it to me, and this is how I interpreted it. And so I went last Sunday and just went away with my guitar. I don't get a lot of chance to do that now. And so I sat with my guitar and I just asked God, I said, do you have something in here and in here and in here and here that you want me to say? And this song came out. And it really is a song about the conflict between our heart and our head and this little space right here that has this conflict of how we can connect these and have peace. It's called Head and Heart. Read, you are the uncreated one, one beyond all time and space. Before all things were made, you were always there. And it was you that gave the breath of life, and out of dust you formed all things. My heart understand, but my head keeps spinning around again. 'Cause the space between my head and heart is bigger than it seems, and this chasm is only filled by a faith I cannot see. And I know I'm supposed to lay my anxiousness down at your feet, I just sometimes can't. 'Cause what my heart believes, my head won't understand. Faith is sure of what we're hoping for, confidence in all unseen. My heart can live in faith, but my head keeps dragging me down. Your feet, I just sometimes can't. 'Cause what my heart believes, my head won't understand. It just won't understand. Will you meet me here in this unbelief? Take my heart, take my mind, lead me on, lead me on. 'Cause the space between my head and heart is bigger than it seems, and this chasm is only filled by a faith I cannot see. I know I'm supposed to lay my anxiousness down at your feet, I just sometimes can't. 'Cause what my heart believes, my head won't understand. Oh, it's hard to understand.
That is one of the best songs I have heard in so long. I mean, is that not amazing? The lyrics, the intensity behind that? Dude, Bring it in. Okay, man. Love you. Just, I thought that is where we live. We want to, we know God is calling us to live a different way. We have this movement in our life to, in the case of today's message, to live generous. I thought every person in this room wants to live that way. But we get stuck with these mental objections, or we get caught in fear, or we have all these what ifs that stop us from living like the way that God meant us to live. And what I'm going to share with you today about breaking a cycle in our lives is true, not only about our money, our resources, it's true about our jobs, about our relationships, that we get stuck in a place that God would love to change us. And so as we begin this, I just want to remind you, we talked about generosity last week. And as we were looking at this question of generosity, we're studying out of a series that Andy Stanley did, and our leadership team did this study about 15 months ago. We thought we've got to do it for Kensington because it's going to set people free. Last week, I told you that Paula and I had just refinished our kitchen. We live in, remember, 2,000 square foot palatial mansion in Rochester, and it's two stories, and we had redone the first floor, the kitchen, repainted the whole first floor, and it's just really exciting. We finished it a week ago Thursday, and we were sitting down going, man, this is great, and we were looking at our schedule and what's coming up, and what's coming up is a birthday party, one-year-old birthday party for our newly adopted grandson, Isaiah. And so he turned three days ago on Thursday, and we're having his birthday today. Well, I said, great, what a great way to start our thing. She said, well, do you remember what she said? She said, actually, there are 120 people that have RSVP'd. And my son-in-law, Cam, who is the uncle to Isaiah, said to Paula, it's not physically possible to get 120 people in your house, but if you want to try it, I'll come over with my moving truck. Remember, if some of you know me, he furnishes apartments for international students at Oakland University. It's one of the things that he loves to do. They come and move in, and he helps them move in. And just, he's amazing. And so they had this discussion. Well, I'm ready to show this great generosity of my home, right? Because they're not bringing presents. We're doing foster care family packages, and the kids are all going to do sparkles and markers and glue and everything in our newly done house. So we got 9 days. Well, Cam ruined my story because he got them the little Methodist church fellowship hall around the corner. So I don't have to lay my life down for my grandson's first year old birthday party. So I can no longer describe myself as a generous person. You see, generosity, though, is defined, we talked about, as a freedom that combines kindness and open-handedness. Remember how we finished the service last week, if you were here, by opening our hands to God. Say, God, bring into my hands and out of my hands whatever it is that you want to do. And all of this with an attitude not of scarcity, but of the abundance of God. That God is going to work through those amazing circumstances. Like, you can open up your life. You can trust God. You can give God your whole life. It's like the church around the corner letting us invade and destroy their fellowship hall this afternoon. Or when I speak about generosity, I honestly don't know, I've never known a group of people more generous than you. Don't know all of you, but I know many of you, and you have laid your life down to be generous. This place, this original Kensington campus, has launched campuses that will reach 11,000 people today, launched 54 churches that will reach 30,000 people today in the U.S., have launched over 2,000 churches around the globe. You are the most generous people I know. But here's what I know. Generous people want to be more generous, and people that have not been able to find a lifestyle practice of generosity want to find it, but they don't know how. They find themselves stuck. So when the Apostle Paul, who was one of the original leaders of the church after Jesus resurrected from the dead 2,000 years ago, he was writing to Timothy, he says this, command them to do good. To be rich, how? Go ahead. In good deeds. In other words, that's what real riches is. It's your ability, not what you keep, but what you give away. He says, and to be generous and willing to share. And if you do this, he's talking to people that believe in Jesus. He says, in this way, they will lay up treasure for themselves as a firm foundation for the coming age. In other words, he's talking about the life after life. He goes, so that they may take hold of the life that is truly life. So do you really want to be alive today? Then be rich in generosity. Because when your life is over and you come to the end, you are not going to be obsessed about how much you've kept or stored. You are going to really focus on how much you've given away. And so today, I just want to ask you this. How do we break this cycle that stops us from living the way that we would really like to live? What stops us from living this life? Because if you can get into this life, I'll make a promise to you. I'll make a promise that when you become generous, you will give more, save more, and consume less. It's just a promise of what God will do in your life. So I want to break this crazy cycle, and I've been praying for especially younger couples. If you could get your life on a new footing today, it would change your life. So here's what I want to do. I want to teach you the crazy cycle and how to get out of it. But before I do that, I had this amazing idea. Actually, I'm lying. It was somebody else's idea. I thought, how could you create a feature-length movie to describe the crazy cycle that we live in that, by the way, is unique to America? I don't see people living this way in South America. I don't see people living this way in Europe or Asia or Africa. I see people living in North America in this crazy cycle. So it's unique to us. In fact, when people come from other parts of the world to live here, they're mystified by what I'm going to teach you today because it's crazy. So we created a full-length feature film for you to enjoy, and then I'm going to teach you the crazy cycle. So take a look.
I'm Stanley Johnson. I've got a great family. I've got a four-bedroom house and a great community. Like my car? It's new. I even belong to the local golf club. How do I do it? I'm in debt up to my eyeballs. I can barely pay my finance charges. Somebody help me.
We put a lot of expense and money into creating that film. We think it's going to go viral. Actually, it probably is. The crazy cycle does include this idea of I'm in debt up to my eyeballs. So let me tell you what crazy is, okay? Crazy is how either a lot of us used to live or we're living right now. And I know a lot of people here over the years who have broken this cycle. So if you're discouraged, you're coming in feeling weighted down by the worries of your life, I'm telling you, there are a lot of people sitting around you who have broken this cycle. So here's how it starts. When people are asked to describe their relationship with money in America, one word appears more than any other word. Would you even guess what it would be? Worry. Worry. Everybody's worried about their money. Everybody's worried. Young people are worried, well, can I save enough money for an engagement ring? You know what I tell young guys? I say, shoot, man, just get a Cracker Jack box. Just get on with it. I hear women going, you know, no, save the money. Wait, no. Get a simple ring. People wonder, will I ever have enough money to buy the house that we really want to buy for our family? Will I have enough to retire on? You know, worry, worry, worry. It's what drives us. And this worry, which is weird, this is uniquely, because people worry about money all over the world. That's not unique. What's unique is the American crazy cycle, which is this. People then begin this practice, and a lot of it's because of advertising and because of what we see we want, we end up spending more than we make. The average American spends 106% of what they make. That's crazy. Thank you. I'm glad you can read. Crazy. Okay? And that leads then to what? You know, debt. It leads to debt. And debt leads to something that's even worse. And this is the part where in my own life, I started to feel constricted in my life. It leads to no margin. This means you're starting to lose the freedom of your life. You know, when you're 18 years old, you're graduating from high school, you really have a lot of freedom to make choices. I watched my son spend 4 years basically being a missionary around the world, Papua New Guinea, Philippines, Singapore, Australia, New Zealand, you know, just and then did an internship here. And at the end of that, zero debt, complete freedom to do that. As we get older, though, something happens. And by the way, our college strategy, our governmental college strategy, is to put chains around our young people. Just want you to know that. Your dream is for your kids to get an education. Believe me, it's an open conspiracy that everybody knows that you get people locked into debt and they spend 10, 20 years paying off debt. And some of it is so crazy. I met a person a few years ago, Greg Mays, who was an art major at New York University. They were gonna end their undergrad with $175,000 in college debt. And they, of course, they're gonna have this great art job where they're just gonna be rolling in the dough. You see, this is what? Tell me. This is crazy. And so, it gets crazier. This no margin, we begin to lose the freedom because we're in debt. It becomes more worry. Only this time, it's greater worry. And it's worry about future consumption. It's a worry to say, I not only can't buy the stuff I need now or the stuff I've been wanting, I can't even see any time in the future when I could buy the stuff I want, because we've been told that buying stuff and consuming is what life's all about. And that leads to what? Not only continuing to spend more than we make, but consuming more than we can afford. We start to have this mindset that's very destructive, and people are living in it. And I'm telling you, some of us that are living today, like I have sweat in my armpits because I lived this way for a few years. And I saw the loss of freedom that was bringing to my life. I wanted to get out of it. Some of you have been living in this for 20 or 30 years, and you're discouraged. You can break this cycle. We've got a Financial Peace University course coming on April 18th. It's gonna start on Tuesday night. I would crawl on my hands and knees to where you're sitting if you would take this course. If your budget and your money, if your consumption is messed up, it actually stopped the fights that my wife and I were having about money for 25 years of our marriage, first 25 years of our marriage. And so we consume more than we afford, and then now we begin to have what we call consumer debt. And this consumer debt is the fact that now we're paying interest for years on stuff that we no longer even own. We're still paying on a car that we got rid of 6 years ago, and we're paying the interest. And I read something that actually blew my mind. I read it this week. Consumer credit debt is now the same as it was before the economic crash of 08. It's like we didn't learn anything. We went right back to what we were doing, back into the craziness. And then this is where it breaks my heart, because not only is it debt about, and consumer debt, and you're just paying on stuff, you're paying more and more on stuff that has less and less value. It leads you to this place where not only is there no margin, but there's no margin for even dreaming about the future. You can't dream about what you're gonna consume in the future. You can't even dream about what you might do in the future. And it's devastating. And I'll tell you why it's devastating. Because when you get in this crazy cycle, if you begin a relationship with Jesus Christ and you start to take risks with God and begin to start to move in this adventure with God, guess what happens? You can't move. You're locked. You're stuck. In 1968, when I was 12 years old, a missionary director of Africa Inland Mission came to our home. I remember, his name was John Gratian. He's gone on to be with the Lord many years ago, and he came and he met with my mom and dad. He said, Chubby, we need a doctor for the hospital in Kajabi, Kenya, at the Africa Inland Mission, where was kind of the mission center for all of Africa. And my dad was 48 years old, and he said, we need a doctor. We've looked all over. We're gonna, in another 2 months, we're gonna be without a doctor. And it was the most advanced hospital in Kenya at the time. In 24 hours, my mom and dad made a decision to go to Africa, to leave their three oldest children, their first grandchild. My brother was a senior in college. My other brother was a senior in high school. He was a high school football and baseball first team All-American, Coach's Magazine. They left and missed his senior year. And they took my sister and I, and we went to Africa. He turned his medical practice over. And you know what the word that everybody used for them, for my mom and dad? Crazy. And I wanna say, who was crazy? Who was crazy after all? Because we had the most amazing year of our life. That was the year that God touched my life. You would not be sitting in this room or watching on live stream or at any Kensington campus today if my mom and dad had not gotten out of this cycle. Because that was the moment that God gave me a vision bigger than just myself and bigger than just living in America and living for the world and seeing that God had called us to love all people in the name of Christ. That's why I love living in Oakland County now, where the whole world is coming here. We got a chance to be engaged and be in relationship. It's super cool. I'm hoping we're gonna rise to the adventure of that. But we won't if we're stuck in the crazies. So, just as a confession, some of you are in credit card debt. I no longer own credit cards. And what's interesting is my story is a little bit different because I was never in debt. I never had any debt in my life until 14 years ago when my first daughter went to college. But I had a crazy mindset that I had to afford whatever dreams my kids had for college. And so by the time my third daughter was a freshman at Cornerstone over on the west side of the state, a little Christian college, I was $118,000 in college loans. I had some of them on credit cards and some on college loans. And we finally brought Dave Ramsey here and I realized that I was what? Crazy. I was on the verge, starting getting my second two kids through college, that I was gonna be $250,000 in debt. And I was gonna spend the rest of my life paying this ridiculous debt. It's stupid. But for some reason, my dad, who was a doctor, had a lot of money, did it for me. I thought I was obligated to do it for my children because I was stuck in this cycle. So for me, it wasn't so much about consumption. It was about a sense of duty that I did not have. And when I stopped doing it, actually, all my kids started working harder, making more money, being more creative, paying their way. It was crazy. And it was at this point where I want to share with you what happened to me that I'd like for it to happen to you today. What happened to me is I began to gain perspective. Sometimes you've got to get to this level of worry that your worry gets to, some of you, your worry is so high about money that you actually have tightness in your physical tightness in your chest. You're worried you're gonna have a heart attack. You're so worried about it. And it's at this point where you're finally ready to gain some sanity and some perspective. And so that's what I want to give you right now. And the perspective is this: you can take this worry and continue in this cycle, or you can recognize something, that the issue has never been money. It's never been money. It's always been self-control. It's never been about money. You can make more money. How much more money would you need to make to stop spending more than what you make? Statistics say it doesn't matter how much you make. If you don't have self-control, you continue to spend more than what you make. People that have $100 million end up losing it all because they spend and do crazy things more than they have. Because unless you have self-control, and this is where you begin to cry out for self-control, you begin to have practices. I remember when we did Dave Ramsey 8 years ago, and I had $120,000 of consumer debt based on college and my mortgage. I realized I had stepped into this cycle. And I went to Dave Ramsey, and the first thing he starts talking about is every month or every pay period having envelopes where you put cash in it. I was so ticked off. I'm like, I lead a large church. I have a lot of responsibility. I drive a Ford Taurus. That's a joke. That's like not even funny. I didn't drive a Ford Taurus. But I drive old cars. I was too proud to start using envelopes. I almost quit the class. You know why? Because self-control is pretty humbling. Self-control means you begin to say no. You begin to restrain your appetite. But here's what I learned. It's what God wants to do for all of us is move us from self-control to contentment. In an 8-year window, it took us 7 years to pay off that debt. I did not buy a new shirt for 7 years. And those of you who know me, I'm living proof, right? Bad, worst dressed pastor in America. Actually, this is a newer shirt. I'm looking good today. This thing of contentment is beautiful. Like, you can live with an old shirt. I thought some of you love to shop. My dad was a hunter. He always loved to buy new shotguns and stuff, and he loved to buy hunting prints and different stuff. And he always went too far on that. The great thing he had was an unbelievable generosity. The thing that kept my dad sane and my mother is they gave away 50% of their gross income almost their whole adult life. Because it was a way of living to break out of the crazies, and they had the crazies. And so it was generosity that began to pull them out. And then contentment with what you have leads then to discipline. Paul and I would sometimes be, we'd manage our money well, and then we'd do revenge spending. You ever do that? And by the way, when I mentioned it earlier, this cycle could be not just about money, it could be about your free time and how you live your free time. Not living it wisely, not living it with self-control, contentment, and discipline. It could be your job, it could be workaholism. It could be a dozen things. And here's what I want you to understand, is that as you start to step into self-control, contentment, and discipline, you realize that the worry was never about money in the first place. What it was really an issue, it was a spiritual issue. It was really about where do you get your sense of value and your sense of well-being. Some of you are gonna get in your you're gonna get in the parking lot, you're gonna drive out, and you're gonna see someone with a nicer car than you, and you're gonna resent it because you're stuck in the crazy cycle. Like, who cares? Paul and I have this fun game. We see cars we really like. We go, we're going to drive that someday. I'm driving a really nice car now. I love it. It's 15 years old. You see, contentment is a beautiful thing. I don't have to have your car, because I realize spiritually what I have is the love of God. And what I have is the freedom to live generously. It's a beautiful way to live. Are you feeling something in you that wants, if you're not living this way, that wants to experience this? You want this contentment, this discipline, this spiritual issue? And I have to say this, because I know some of you are thinking, well, you know, if I had what you had, I would be content. You know, you see somebody, you have a friend that's they own their own business, and they're a multimillionaire, and they own their business. You go, well, if I had them, I would be content. But you know what the real answer is. You wouldn't be content. In fact, the more money you get, every statistic we find is that the more money you have, what? You're more or less worried? More. I've had a chance in my life to know 4 or 5 people that were worth hundreds of millions of dollars to billions. And some of them I'm pretty good friends with. It's never transferred to me. And part of it's cool is part of my position. I'm a safe person because I don't care. Not because I'm a noble person. I just never cared about things. It's the way God made me. I care about mission. I care about us moving forward in the world. Now, I care about that. I'd love to have hundreds of millions of dollars for that, but I could care less about a new pair of shoes or a new whatever. But here's what I've learned from those people. Golly, they're worried about their kids, how they're going to pass on their resources. They're worried about, you know, every day, every movement of the stock market. They're worried about everything. Worry is universal. Spiritual trust in God that's built around a new lifestyle of self-control, contentment, and discipline is a miracle. It's a miracle when you say, I got this gap between my head and my heart, and somehow I'm going to trust God for the gap. That's what Danny was singing. I'm going to trust God for the gap because I'm going to have to just lean into him and trust him. But here's the cool thing. When this happens, there's a freedom to say no, a freedom to turn worry into true freedom, into true choice, free to pursue what God calls you to do, free to turn consuming into giving, free to turn debt into surplus, and free to find margin to live a new life. Boy, it's a beautiful thing. So here's the answer. Generosity is the path off the crazy cycle. Because people have been living this for all time. In fact, Jesus tells one of his most powerful stories in Luke chapter 12 about a rich man who was stuck in the crazy cycle. Some of you will remember the story. It says, the ground of a certain rich man yielded an abundant harvest. What do you notice immediately about this guy? He's what? What does he say it? He's rich, but he's just had a great year on the stock market. He's just had a great year in his business. He's just had a great year with his harvest. And so he has extra. He didn't need the extra. He was already rich. Now he's richer. And so he starts thinking to himself, What shall I do? I have no place to store my crops. He goes, I got all this wealth. I have no place to put it. He has the mindset of what? What I get is mine to consume or mine to hoard. That's his, the only two options that even occur to him. They're mine to consume or mine to afford. And then he says, this is what I'll do. You guess what he's gonna do? It's a definition of crazy. He's gonna do what he's always done. The definition of crazy is to continue to do what you've always done and expect different results. If you're in debt today, up to your eyeballs like Stanley Johnson, and you continue to do what you've done to this point, then you are actually, could be termed clinically crazy. And we've all done it. He goes, I'm gonna assume it's all for me. And then he goes, I'll tear down my barns. I'll build bigger ones. And there I'll store my surplus grain. Because I'm gonna save it now to consume later or hoard it now to dispose later. This is the perfect image. Anybody watch the Hobbit movie or read the book? The Hobbit? Anybody watch the movie or read the book? Let me just see a show of hands. Anybody? Okay, come on, guys. Okay, this is beautiful stuff. So what is the dragon is the richest creature in Middle Earth. And what does he do with his resources? He sleeps on it. That's all he does. He just sleeps on it. He does nothing with it. He assumes it's his to sleep on. It makes no sense. And so that's what this guy, he's gonna build bigger barns because I just wanna go out and walk through and feel the grain in my hands and look at the barn and know it's full. And I'll say to myself, this is the dream. This guy was living the American dream 2,000 years ago. You have plenty of grain, speaking to himself. It's like modern pro athletes. They talk about themselves in the third person. Well, Steve Andrews, you know, whatever, it's crazy. You have plenty of grain laid up for many years. Take life easy, eat, drink, and be merry. Sandy Stanley was teaching this. He had a great insight. He said, you know what? This is a good plan. If. It's a good plan if. It's a good plan if you have many years to live. It's a good plan. There's nothing wrong, believe me. We have always taught, give 10%, save at least 10%. Invest for the future, super important. I would even say as you get older, invest more than 10% to save and then live on the rest. Be more generous, give more than 10%, save more than 10%, live on even less. That's the way of wisdom. That's the way of generosity. But this guy, he's got one dream. It's all about him. He's living the Andrews family motto, I may not be much, but I'm all I think about. It's taking life easy, eat, drink, and be merry. It's a good plan if you have many years. So let me ask you a question. How many people here today and on stream, you can even raise your hand on stream, be weird, but you can do it. How many of you have many years of life left? Go ahead, raise your hand. You have many years of life left. Actually, you're wrong. Drop your hand. You don't even know if you have one more breath left. Isn't that amazing? Because when I first asked myself the question, I'm like, gosh, I'm young. I want to live a long time. But you don't know. You may have many years, but you don't know. Nancy Worm, who's our campus, marvelous campus director, incredible person, her husband Joe actually is the guy that launched the first four other Kensington campuses. Nobody even knows that. He just built teams, did an amazing job for us. He's had a friend since childhood named Rick. All through the years at Kensington, he would invite Rick to come to Easter, Christmas, and Rick would show up once in a while. And sometimes Rick would sit where you are and he'd be moved by the message or by a song like Danny's or something. And sometimes he would even cry, but then he would drift away and he wouldn't come regularly. He'd always just kind of doing his own thing. This last week, Joe called him up to invite him to church. Said, hey man, I miss you, I love you. Rick's like, yeah, I love you too, Joe. He said, hey, Easter's coming, I'd love to have you come. He's like, okay, you know, think about that. And Joe, thank you for thinking about me. Thank you for caring about me. Less than a week ago, about 9 o'clock at night, I think, and Joe hung up. Rick never wakes up the next morning, 59 years of age, thought he had many years to live. He's gone. And that leads us to the last part of this. God says to him, you fool, this very night your life will be demanded from you. Listen, if you take even one breath for granted, God says to us, we're fools for doing that. And he says, this is how it will be. And you know what it'll be? It will be, let's say it out loud together, for this guy, the rich guy, it's what? It's total loss. Everything is gone. Jesus says, this is how it will be with whoever stores up things for themselves but is not rich toward God. It's like you really have two choices. You can spend your whole life obsessing about yourself and worry, worry, worry. Or you can say, how can I live my life? How can I begin self-control and contentment and discipline practices through the power of the Holy Spirit, Jesus working in me, through community of people, through going to FPU, where I can begin to live such a life that I can really live differently and see great things happen. And over the years here, I've seen thousands and thousands of people do this. I've also seen people walk right back into the crazy cycle. And it's so constricting. This is how it will be if you're not rich towards God. So let me ask you this question as we wrap up this service. If I could offer you a practice that could break the cycle of greed and foolishness and build generosity, would you consider trying this practice? Would you consider it? Okay. That's what I'm gonna ask you to do in just a minute. So hold on, before we do that, we're gonna receive our offering. Ushers can come down. Dave and Ann Wilson, who by the way, did an amazing job. There were over 1,200 couples that did the marriage conference this weekend at Troy and Orion. It was amazing, and I'm hoping we're gonna post some of it online for others who are married or engaged or dating to see and learn from this. It was really awesome. And but Dave and Ann were recorded, and they are going to invite us. We've done this before, but today and next week, we're gonna invite people to consider a practice that could begin to get you off the crazy cycle.
Dave and Ann Wilson here, and we welcome you to our home. We're actually sitting on the couch where I have many times struggled with trusting God. One of the dominant themes of the Word of God is trust. Trusting God with every single area of our lives.
Which can be really scary because we're talking about our marriages, our future,
our kids,
our lives.
Yeah, and I tell you what, one of the hardest areas for me is money. It's been a real struggle for many years, actually. We had many fights right here in this family room. I would lay on this couch watching TV, Ann's over there, starting to rip checks out of the checkbook to pay our bills, and I would just freak out.
He would leave the room, and he would be in a bad mood for days, even after I paid the bills, because he was so stressed and gripped with, like, fear.
Yeah, my security for many years was tied to a number in a bank account. It wasn't really tied to trusting God. Even though I knew God would provide, I really struggled with believing that. It all came down to one word, fear.
And the thing that we've seen about fear is the more fearful I become, the more controlling I become. And it's almost like we hold on to the things that we want to control. And this is the look. Our fists are closed and we're holding on for dear life because of our fear. And God's asking us to trust him, which is so scary because it's opening our hands to him. And this is a position of both receiving and giving, because when we're like this, how can we receive from God?
Yeah, the interesting thing for me is I was like this with my life.
Oh, that's true.
And even maybe our career and future and our ministry, and yet I was like this with our money, because that was the one that got me. It had my heart. And I got to be honest, you know, I've realized, and I've said this many times at Kensington, faith is a choice. And I can remember reading Philippians 4:19, where Paul just writes these simple words, and my God shall supply all of your needs according to the riches in Christ Jesus. And it was, you know, it was something I had taught before, and I remember just reading that one day, and I was like, do I believe this? And it was a choice that we made. I had to make myself to go from like this with my money to like, okay, I'm going to give. I'm going to obey God's word and what he says about giving back to him.
I could see it in Dave as he let go. The thing that happened was he was released from his fear. He's always tempted to take it back, but he found this freedom, and we found this freedom in our relationship even.
So I'll tell you what, when we went from this to this with our money, we experienced freedom. Mm-hmm. And that's what we want you to experience. So we are inviting you into a journey that we're calling the Whole 90. For the next 90 days, we're inviting you to join us to take the whole tithe, 10%, and give it back to God for 90 days.
Yeah, and I'm sure a lot of you have heard of the Whole 30, where it's an eating, diet, plan, cleansing thing. Well, this is the same idea of that, is you're getting control of your eating. This is kind of giving release to God of our money.
So for the next 90 days, join us and we'll give 10% back to God and we'll watch him provide. He'll take care of us. I'm not gonna say you're gonna get a new car or your basement's not gonna flood, but I can make you this promise. God is gonna meet you in a way you may never have seen him meet you before. We have seen that in our relationship with God, especially with money, as we decided to give 10%, we have seen a peace we didn't know.
Well, and there's not necessarily a change in our money per se, but there's a change in our peace and our contentment and our trust. And that has given us life and it's given us hope for our future, because our hope is in Jesus, not in our bank account.
Yeah, and I've found that I can lay on this couch while we pay bills and know that there's a God that is faithful and has met us financially and in every other way of our life. He can be trusted. And here's the amazing thing. I believe that you're gonna discover the exact same thing over the next 90 days. But let me tell you this, if you decide to tithe to Kensington and after 90 days you decide, man, I don't think that was a good idea. I don't wanna keep doing this. We will give you your money back. We'll refund everything back that you gave to Kensington to give it back to you, because we believe you're gonna discover just what we've discovered. God is faithful, God can be trusted, and you will meet him in a way you've never met him before.
Every couple of years we invite people to consider this. It's a live practice. The ushers are gonna come down with a pamphlet. It says Whole 90. And you don't have to, there's not gonna be any pressure on this. We're gonna invite you to consider something. Inside is a little tear-off pamphlet, and where it asks for your name and phone number and email address, what campus you attend. If you're a part of Kensington, I'm asking you to really consider this invitation of the tithe. The tithe is giving 10% of your income back to God here today. We're saying if you'd like to do a 90-day trial run that's completely risk-free, you do it at Kensington. If you want to give it to the Detroit Zoo, you can ask them for a trial run. They might actually do it, or save the whales. But for us, you say, why Kensington? Why here? Because it allows us to be a team creating ripple effects in the world for Christ. Ripple effects here and around the globe. The tithe is a practice that's premeditated. You don't just do it. You got to plan it. It's specific. And it's a decision to emancipate or give freedom to your resources to work for the kingdom of God. And so as this pamphlet comes around to you, there's gonna be five options along the way. These five options are simply, the first one is, guess I better look at it. By the way, are you guys still waiting in that back section for them? Still coming? Still working your way back? The first one is simply this. I will give 10% for 90 days. I accept the challenge. This means that you're ready to see God's faithfulness. See, how might your life change if you do this? In years past, we've done this, and we've had hundreds of people take us up on it. The last time we did this 3 years ago, we had 17 people that asked for a refund of their money after 90 days. And we had about 2,000 people do it. It was pretty cool. But 17, so it's risk-free, it's no hassle. We don't post your name anywhere. I don't know who those 17 people are. That was all in the finance department. The second one is similar to it, but it's a decision to increase your giving. You may not be giving 10%, but you're already giving a portion of your income, but you're giving less than 10%. Maybe you're not ready to give 10% yet, but you're ready to increase your giving for the next 90 days. So in this case, you select that option. By the way, as you're filling out this card, nothing is gonna happen with this card. It's simply gonna be a record for us. You're gonna have to go online or connect with our office in order to register on our Kensington web application for this. In fact, if you're watching on live stream, which I know hundreds and hundreds of you are right now, You can, there's a link right now where you're looking. You can do it on your phone or your iPad or your computer and be a part of this with us. But you might be giving 2%. You say, well, I'm gonna test 10% just feels too scary, but I'll try 4%. Trust God with that. Number three is I'm gonna start giving a percentage for the first time in my life. It could be 10%. It could be 2% or 3%. But maybe you've never given a dime, and you're gonna take this faith step. Man, we'd love to see you jump at the 10% level and trust God. I know some of you are gonna do that today. But as a first step, you're not ready to do that, you could do this right now. The fourth option is I'll continue to give 10% of my income or more. And you know how that, for me to even read that, you know what it means? Is in this room are an army of people who have gone to war with Danny and Norm and me and our whole team for many, many years. You've just been in the battle with us. And it feels like a holy moment for me to say thank you for being in this journey of trusting God, of worshiping and honoring God with your resources by investing them with us. I was thinking of the unbelievable things that God has done. I'm thinking of the 54 churches we've been able to launch in the U.S. The fact that I thought, some of you say, well, what if I do this? What is it going to mean for Kensington? Well, this last year we helped start 1,300 new churches and house churches around the globe. What if by the year 2027 we start 13,000 new churches and house churches around the globe? You say, well, how would that happen? It would happen through us giving and joining as an army of people to serve God, move in the world, serve this community. The last one, then, number five, is to say, no, thank you. I will not give it this time. And if you're not planning on giving, we'd still love for you to mark it. We'd love to know that there are people that are, and you don't even have to sign your name if you want. But it'd be cool to have you on our database to say just no thank you. That's a step of complete integrity as well. It's just as cool as any of those decisions because you're trying to listen to the nudging of God. And if you do write number five, no thank you, some of you are thinking, I'm so messed up financially, I can't give anything. Then this is where FPU, Financial Peace University, could be a phenomenal step. It's changed millions of lives around the country and around the world. April 18th. Tuesday night, mark it on your calendar. Go out to Starting Point Table and connect with the guys out there, the men and women out there, and they'll connect you along the way. So as one body, I want you to just take the next 2 minutes, not take long. Some of you might not be ready to mark it. You say, well, I'm gonna take it home and really talk about it with my spouse, but here's what I really believe. I really believe, because I know myself and I do know people well, most of you know what you should do right now on these five. You already felt the nudging. You do it. You might mark number one and go have a talk with your wife later and you decide to do number two or number three. That's fine. No judgment. Nobody's. It's just us having a record for us to plan. But I'm saying, what if you really did begin to say, I've always wanted to be a generous person and I'd love to invest in a team of people that are living their lives with their hair on fire, living proof here, for Christ in the world. And if this is your first time at Kensington, obviously you don't want to do it here. Do it somewhere else. Do it for a cause that you'd be willing to give your life for. Take a couple minutes, pray about it, and you do what God is nudging you to do. And then Danny's going to sing, lead us a little song, and the ushers are going to come down and just collect the little strip cards that are at the bottom of your pamphlet. Thank you.
not skilled to understand what God has willed, what God has planned. I only know at his right hand stands one who is my Savior. I take him at his word and deed. Christ died to save me, this I read. And in my heart I find a need for him to be my Savior. That he should leave his place on high and come for sinful men to die. You count it strange, so once did I, before I knew my Savior. providence. I will rest. My confidence is your faithful. Now here's the deal. Many times I have conversations and people go, why do we keep singing the same thing over and over and over? You're killing me. I got it the first time, right? Maybe you didn't, but here's what we do. What we're seeing there is the promises of God. And sometimes between our head and heart, they don't understand those promises. And sometimes through repetition, it's a form of meditation. We're meditating on the Word of God. That's what we're doing. So by singing, I will rest in your promises. You know what Scripture says? Here's a promise that Scripture says, you will never be alone in your whole life when you put your faith in me, that I'm with you always to the end of the ages, and so now you can rest. That's just one promise. Also, it says, come to me, all you who are burdened, who have worries, who have weights. Does anyone that have that today? I know I do. Come, and God says what? What's his promise? He says, come to me and I will give you rest. So when we sing that first line, that's what we're singing. We're singing truth. And then the second one, right? I'm going to find confidence where? In God's faithfulness. That means he is a faithful God. He's always going to be there. So I want you to sing these lines with that in mind, that truth. That's why we sing sometimes, because sometimes there is no truth here, but when we put it out here, all of a sudden in the community becomes real. So I will rest. My confidence. Sing it like you believe it. There you go. Up to him. My confidence, Lord, Lord, Lord. I will. My confidence. I will. My confidence, beautiful, is your faithfulness.
Lord, thank you. So awesome. Thank you for Danny just teaching us again that we can count on your promises. Just think back on every precious man, woman, boy, and girl in this room, how much you love them and care for them. Lord, and some of them are taking a step of generosity, step of faith today, step to break the crazy cycle. I pray especially for the young families, young couples, that you would start them on this pattern, this life, where Jesus, you live at the center of their life, and it's not built on greed and consumption, but about wisdom and self-control and contentment in who you are and living for a bigger picture. So do that in us, we pray in Jesus' name, amen. Man, it's so great to be with you. I just want to say some of you need prayer. Right now, we'll have a prayer team down front in the lobby. We'd love to see you at Starting Point, get your Easter tickets. Thank you for such joy in being with you. You guys are awesome.